So I'm going to talk to you about Culfoich Farm, which is up near Grantland Spey, and some of the work that we do on Culfoich. I'll introduce myself first. You might know me as that neep from the QMS adverts. And just to continue on with what Dee was saying, if I was a cow, I would be over fat, so I'd be penalised. I also work for the Cairngorms National Park Authority as their farming advisor, so there's a little bit of influence there on the farm management policy. So I try to practice what I preach a little bit. So Culfoich is two different farms, Ballinlagh and Culfoich, which are connected by a bit of hill. It's 1,900 hectares, which is nowhere near as impressive as it sounds. There's very little grass, so there's very little business for our loyal grass agent sitting over there. We're a tenanted farm on Tulkin Estate, which has recently been taken over by a Russian oligarch. So interesting times for everyone. We're largely left to our own devices, which is quite good for us, though. We're in a secure tenancy, so we're very lucky as far as that goes. The farm was started originally by my late grandfather on the left here, Ray of Sunshine, and is now managed by my father, who's the wee bald manny in amongst the cows. Although I will make a good go at telling people that I'm the brains of the operation. So this is a view of the top of our hill. Not all of that ground is ours, unfortunately. More's a pity. We have about 200 hectare of improved grassland. That includes some of the permanent grassland as well, mostly permanent grassland as well. I've obviously taken that photo because that's by far and away the best bit. That's the nicest bit of grass. So if you could just go away thinking that it's all like that, I'd be quite happy. We even have some what you would call ploughable land. I'll not call it arable because that's a bit of a stretch. But unfortunately, most of our ground, or fortunately, most of our ground looks like this, which is rough hill. That's a nice pine regen as well on the hill. So in order to farm it effectively, my grandfather was a big fan of saying that you have to make the farming system fit the land because you cannot make the land fit the farming system. So we have 400 Scottish blackface ewes that are put 50% back to the blackface for replacements and 50% to cheviot tups for a more commercial ewe, and then they're put to the Beltex. All the sheep are on the hill, apart from the cheviot gimmers who go to the Beltex, who are kept in by. That's just an experiment we're starting just now to try and get a bit more commercial edge. But we've chosen the Scottish blackface not because of the incredibly high prices they yield, but because they're very hard sheep, and they will survive on the hill, and they'll survive most conditions on the hill as well. They're very tough sheep, they're difficult to work with, and as you can see, they're very vicious. Cattle are our main point of income. The sheep bring in a lot of subsidy, but the cattle bring in a lot of turnover for the business. We have 50 cows, and the majority of them are Highland Cross Shorthorn, Highland Crosses, and Pure Highland. We're in the process of changing, and I'll explain why we're changing in a minute. We also have a herd of pedigree Aberdeen Angus cows. I should point out that the nice pictures are the ones that my wife's taken, so I'll take no credit for that, otherwise I'll get in trouble. We have a pedigree herd of Aberdeen Angus because we've got so much money, we thought we'd start a pedigree herd to lose some of it. I suppose that's our USP. We do a little bit of agri-tourism as well. It's mostly farm tours. It's all farm tours. We don't accommodate anyone. And the agri-tourism side of our business is not for income. It's all for charity, because I'm a director of the Royal Highland Education Trust Highland area, and we like to charge buses of foreign farm tourists to come visit the farm, see the work that we're doing here, and we donate all the funds to the Royal Highland Education Trust. We are an unusual farm, however, it seems pretty mundane at the moment, but we are an unusual farm because we do a lot of pedigree livestock. I don't know how that picture got in there. That just happens to be the winning male champion at the Royal Highland Show this year. We do a lot of pedigree livestock, specifically pedigree cattle. So we've been doing quite well with pedigree Highland cattle, although the money doesn't always follow the tickets. We've just started, as I said, the pedigree Aberdeen Angus herd. So we go down to the bull sales with bulls as much as we possibly can. We've recently sold them to a high of 4,000 guineas, which is not a massive price, but it's quite good for us in only 5 years. It seems like a waste of money doing the pedigree herds, but for us, this is the most important thing that we do on the farm, and we are meticulous and obsessive with this to the point that it is dangerous. We cost everything out to the penny per litre of diesel, per, you know, kilogram of straw, kilogram of barley. Everything is costed out. I have whiteboards in every single shed. I call them Bruce's boards of misery, and I go through all the daily live weight gains of all the cattle, of all the sheep, to try and make sure that everything is paying its way, basically, even if it's in the smallest possible way. Because, and I'm going to talk about conservation, I promise, ultimately you can't be green if you're in the red. So above all else, we're trying to be a sustainable business. And sustainability, I don't know if any of you saw Doug Avery when he came over from New Zealand, but Doug Avery talked about sustainability being the three-legged milking stool. It was social sustainability, environmental sustainability, and economic sustainability. And you cannot work unless you've got all three. You cannot be sustainable unless you're all three. So the social sustainability comes through all the outreach work we do, all the agritourism work we do, the speaking I do. The economic sustainability comes from the costings that I do and keeping everything ticking over all right. But the environmental sustainability is the key to it all. And above everything, nature is at the heart of our business. So for the last 10 years, we've been certified organic by SOPA. And we will be organic until the 31st of December. Whether or not we maintain our organic status is still a little bit up in the air. There are pros and cons for organic systems, as we've learned. The cons are these things and these things. We find it difficult to cope with adverse weather, with variety of seeds available, with our grassland management, and the cost of feed. However, there are some huge pros for the organic system, so I'll not downplay it too badly. We get a good payment, we get a good premium on beef, and above all, it has taught us some phenomenal lessons on grassland management and rotational grazing and things like that. And I would recommend it to everyone if it fits with your business, because, I mean, ultimately, we're on the very edge of where the organic system works. We're fighting off a weed epidemic at a rate of knots, so it maybe doesn't work with us, but we will take the lessons we've learned and go into a very sustainable system, very low input system, and we'll use as little inputs as possible, spray-wise, fertilizer-wise, because we want to look after the soil. And if the more you put into the soil, the more you have to keep putting into the soil. So while our biggest natural asset is the natural capital on the farm, it's also the biggest obstacle we come up against. We have herds of up to 100 red deer that inflict a lot of damage on silage ground. Unfortunately, the deer are all owned by the estate, so we can't cull them ourselves, and when we ask them to cull them, they don't seem too enthusiastic. We get lots of fun, challenging weather conditions. 2009, 2010 snowfall, I'm sure we all remember that. We had temperatures as low as minus 30 degrees and a 12-foot level fall of snow. Last year, I was in the paper moaning because we had 62 days with no rain, and we're a very freely draining place, and we had 5 hours a day, every day, spent pumping water out of the River Spey to feed livestock. But the good side of nature is that every single bit of nature, no matter how mundane, is an indicator as to how we're farming. So no matter how small it is, and I'm sure someone will be able to identify that, but I can't, or how rare the different species are on the farm, they're the indicator as to whether or not we're doing a good job. So we've got some really nice aspen woodlands, we've got some really nice native pine woodlands, and we've got probably the most important freshwater system in Scotland, the River Spey, right on our doorstep. We farm the banks of the River Spey, and everything we do has to make sure that the River Spey maintains its pristine condition. We don't do a lot of paid work or active work on the freshwater pearl mussels, other than summertime I'll go for a swim, and there are thousands of them down below the farm, which is quite impressive. But we've approached the Spey Fisheries Board, and they seem quite happy with what we're not doing, really, because we're not really doing anything to protect them, but they seem quite happy, so I'm quite happy. We've planted almost 20 kilometres of hedges as well, and they are an essential food for livestock, for wildlife, as you can see there with the little bee. They're an essential form of shelter, which help livestock retain condition and have a better quality of life, and they are a fantastic wildlife corridor, wildlife habitat, and they've been invaluable to us. They've contributed more than anything else we've done in the business in the last 50 years, easily. everything starts from the soil. Everything we do starts from the soil. It comes from the soil up. Everything that you look at with the cattle, with the sheep, everything comes from the soil because it's the grass they eat, the quality of the grass they eat. It's the quality of the oxygen in the soils, the minerals in the soils. And how do we know it's in good condition? Well, worms are a good indicator because worms usually means there's plenty of nutrients in the soil for the worms to feed off. And how do you tell there's worms without digging up every single patch of soil? You get plenty of these guys. So we're very lucky to have a huge amount of wading birds, lapwings that come early in the spring with the oyster catchers, and my favorite, the curlews, who come slightly later on. A good indication as to how the soil's doing is whether or not, or how the birds behave. And this year we've noticed that a lot of lapwings are coming in later on in the summer, not nesting in the spring, but they're coming later on in the summer to feed, which means there might be a deficiency in the soil. So we're gonna hopefully get a lot of the soil tested, and we've done it before, have the soil tested when the bird habits change, and it usually means the soil's lacking in something. So we'll probably get some soil sampling done later on this year and address the issue with some liming, some potash, whatever it needs. And there's a nice picture to go aw. You're supposed to go aw. So we work a lot with the Strathspey Wetland Waders Initiative, who are focused in Strathspey and do a lot of different types of work to improve wading bird habitat. They loan out equipment, they loan out an aerator, and they loan out a flail mower so that we can open up dense tussocky swards to improve the habitat for young chicks. We've also done some interesting work ourselves. We have a lot of wet ground on the farm, just up there. You can see the water courses there. All that was too wet to put any livestock on, but we've done some, what I'm calling, extensive re-wiggling. So we've drained that by putting in drainage throughout, more natural drainage than the traditional straight drains that feed into wet feeding sites, but they've also drained a lot of that area in the red so that we can now put cattle back on it, and they provide a really good feeding site for all the wading birds on the farm. Again, though, everything comes back to the soil that we have, and I was saying about worms being a good indication of healthy soil. Moles eat worms, so the more moles, the better. So if you want to tell yourself that moles are a good thing, it helps your sanity, I find. Not only do we want to keep the soil healthy, we want to keep it where it's supposed to be. That's some nice runoff. That's not my field, by the way, if anyone from SEPA's in. We planted a lot of buffer strips around field edges that we do cultivate. We also try to keep grass fresh and healthy, and this is the most important tool on our farm. It helps to pull out the dead grass and let the fresh stuff through. We also try to look after soil nitrogen by making sure there's enough clover in the sward. That's a 30-year-old lay of grass, and that's all white clover that's coming through it, and that's just through careful management and grazing. From now on, I hope to put a lot more wildflowers into grazing mixtures, looking at you, and hopefully we can get a bit more diversity in the sward. And the main lesson that I try to tell people is all the decisions we make are to save money. That is our number one interest. We're trying to save money. We're trying to make our business more profitable, more efficient. But everything we do to save money ends up saving the environment in some way as well. So we strip graze. That's designed to keep the cattle out for longer, but it spreads the farm, you know, it spreads the manure around longer. It helps the grass open up more. It poaches the grass to let the new stuff through. We unwind bales. That's not my tractor. We're not profitable enough to have John Deere's. But we use a bale unwinder because we want the cattle to eat every single bit of bale. But again, it allows the ground to be more less poached up throughout the winter because we're not using ring feeders, and it allows the manure to be spread around the place. And next year, we are hoping to go back to pit silage because of the plastic waste, above all else, because it's costing us £4 or £5 a bale to wrap it in plastic, so we might as well go back to pit silage. And again, it cuts down on this horrible plastic waste that you see all over the place. And on another note, I'm always keen to force the point that as farmers, we have a duty to inform the next generation of customers. We have to tell them what we're doing, because in this climate that we're in just now, I mean socially, politically, if we don't get our message out there, the other messages will take over. So it's important to educate the next generation of consumers. And I'm also trying to educate already the next generation in our house, and make sure that the message gets passed on. So I'm not sure that was entirely what I was asked to speak about, but I did a bit of improvisation there. But thank you very much for putting up with me.